Brewing by A. Chaston Chapman. Preface. Great is the debt of gratitude which the brewing industry owes to the labors of scientific men. It has been more than repaid by the immense services which that industry has indirectly rendered to the advancement of modern science. It may be said without exaggeration that in respect of the number of scientific investigations of the first order of importance to which it has given rise, the brewing industry stands easily preeminent among the industries of mankind, and that without the stimulus furnished by the desire to arrive at the meaning of some of the more important phenomena connected with the brewing of beer, both chemical and biological science would probably be the poorer today by some of their most valued intellectual achievements. In support of this statement, it is only necessary to refer to the investigation of the chemical and other changes occurring during the growth of the barleycorn, the elucidation of the mechanism of the hydrolysis of starch by diastases, the nature of enzyme action, and last, but not least, the numerous researches into the nature of fermentation, with all the wonderful chemical and biological facts which those researches have revealed. Whilst all this is indisputably true, it is unfortunately a fact that about no other industry do so much ignorance and misconception exist, even on the part of intelligent and well-educated people. The brewing of beer is regarded by many as an operation of a simple and more or less mechanical description, which is not of sufficient importance to merit study or of sufficient interest to claim a share of their attention. It is in the hope of doing something, even though it be but little, to correct this widely spread impression that I have most willingly accepted the invitation to contribute this little work to the Cambridge Manuals of Science and Literature. To prevent any misunderstanding, I may say at once that it is not intended to serve as a textbook for the student of brewing, and still less as a handbook for the practical brewer. In it I have only referred to methods of practical working when such reference was necessary for the purpose of affording a general view of the process, or appeared to render the application of certain principles more intelligible. I have, in fact, contained myself, as far as possible, to an explanation of the principles underlying the various parts of the brewing process, and have endeavored, in describing these, to employ language which should be intelligible to the well-educated layman, for whom this book is primarily intended. In dealing in so small a compass with a subject covering such vast areas in the dominions of both biology and chemistry, the difficulty of knowing precisely what to include and what to omit has been very great, and this must be my excuse should any of my readers detect what they regard as errors of omission, or consider that I have submitted the subject to unduly great compression. The illustrations of brewing plant have been very kindly provided for me by Messrs. William Bradford and Sons, to whom my thanks are due. I am also indebted to Professor Percival and to Messrs. Duckworth and Co. for permission to use the drawing representing the structure of the hop cone, and to Mr. Harold Wagner, F.R.S., for permission to use the drawing representing the structure of the yeast cell, and to my assistant, Mr. B.F. Sawbridge, M.A., for preparing certain of the photomicrographs. A.C.C. London, July, 1912. Chapter 1. Introduction. The origin of beer, using that word in a general sense to indicate a fermented infusion of grain, is lost in the mists of antiquity. Probably the Egyptians were among the first civilized people to engage in the art of brewing, and there appears to be good reason for believing that barley wine, or beer, was well known in Egypt at least 3,000 years before the Christian era. Herodotus, who is not always a model of trustworthiness, mentions that the Egyptians used a wine made from barley because there were no vines in their country, but this is clearly not correct, since wine was well known to the ancient Egyptians, and its use is recorded as early as 4,000 years B.C. It seems certain, moreover, that at that early period there were many vineyards in the Nile Valley, and that several kinds of wine were produced. Still, it is not altogether unreasonable to suppose that in parts of the world where the grape would not grow, beer occupied the same position as wine in countries where the vine flourished. Among the ancient Hebrews, beer was well known, and although the word shekar, used by Moses and occurring several times in the Pentateuch, might refer merely to strong drink in general, yet there seems to be good reason for supposing that it did in reality refer to an intoxicating drink prepared from barley. It may be mentioned in this connection that there is an old rabbinical tradition that the Jews were free from leprosy during the captivity in Babylon by reason of their drinking sisera, shekar, made bitter with hops. If there be any truth in this, it is of special interest as showing at what an early period hops were used for flavoring purposes. But it was among the peoples of Western and Northwestern Europe that beer was most largely consumed, and among the Gauls, Germans, Scandinavians, Celts, and Saxons, it had attained in very early times to the position of a national beverage. Some uncertainty attaches to the etymology of the words ale and beer, but there is very little doubt that the former, Saxon ilu, Danish ol, is of Scandinavian, and the latter probably of Teutonic origin, both words being used indiscriminately during Anglo-Saxon times. After a time the word beer appears to have dropped out of use in this country and was not again employed until about the 15th century, when the use of hops became general, the word being then applied to the hopped in contradistinction to the unhopped beverage or ale. At the present day the two words are very largely synonymous, beer being used comprehensively to include all classes of malt liquor, whilst the word ale is applied to all beers other than stout and porter. Prior to the Roman invasion, it is probable that mead, or fermented honey, was the beverage most commonly used in this country on festive occasions, and there can be little doubt that it is the most ancient of the intoxicating drinks of Western Europe. Next in point of antiquity came cider, and then, with advancing civilization, beer. One of the earliest references to the use of ale in these islands is to be found in the Cenchus Mór, which dates from the 5th century, and which shows that ale was well known in Ireland at the time of the arrival of St. Patrick. In Wales, too, about the same time, ale competed with mead as the drink of the wealthy. Among the Danes and Anglo-Saxons, beer was certainly the favorite beverage, and its virtues are celebrated in many of their most ancient poems. It will be remembered that their conception of the highest felicity attainable by their heroes after death was to drink in the halls of Odin long draughts of ale from the skulls of their enemies slain in battle. It is not within the scope of this book to deal at any length with the history of beer, and it will suffice to say that from the 5th century onwards, the popularity of beer increased to such an extent that from being the occasional beverage of the wealthy, it had become in the Middle Ages the general drink of all classes. The ale most commonly consumed by the poorer classes was doubtless low in strength and poor in quality, and in this connection the following lines from Piers Plowman are of interest. In speaking of the independence of the laboring classes, consequent upon the scarcity of labor after the Great Plague in the 14th century, Piers says, "Neen on halfpenny ale in nonwise drink, both of the best and the brownest that Brewster Sullen." It is clear that at this time ales of several kinds or strengths were brewed, and in old documents of the 13th and 14th centuries, the words prima, secunda, and tertia, as applied to beer, occur on several occasions. Later, in the reign of Henry VIII, the brewers were restrained from making more than two kinds of beer, the strong and the double, and the prices at which these were to be sold were fixed by statute. This restriction seems to have been withdrawn, for later we again find that several varieties of beer were produced and sold. The ease with which the operations involved in the production of beer from malted grain could be carried out resulted in the installation of brewing plant in the houses of vast numbers of the wealthier classes, and almost every housewife of importance may be said to have been her own brewer. During the 18th century, this practice fell largely into disuse, and the brewing of beer passed for all practical purposes into the hands of the public brewer. At the beginning of the reign of King William, the duty on strong beer, or ale, was 1 shilling and 3 pence per barrel, and the price charged by the brewer to his customers, who usually fetched it themselves from the brewery, was 16 shillings per barrel. After our wars with France, the duty was increased by 9 pence per barrel on strong beer, and in 1694 it amounted to 4 shillings and 9 pence on strong and 1 shilling and 3 pence on light beer. In the reign of Queen Anne, the excise duty on malt, which had been originally imposed during the reign of Charles I, but subsequently repealed, was reimposed, and a tax on hops was levied, which remained in force until 1862. Towards the end of the 17th and at the beginning of the 18th centuries, The beer chiefly consumed in London was a mixture of heavy sweet ale with a lighter, bitter beer, and a still weaker, or small beer. About the year 1722, a beer was introduced which had the flavor and general qualities of a mixture of the three, and as its chief patrons were the laboring classes and porters, it became known by the name of porter. This beverage made rapid headway, and in the early part of the 19th century it constituted the great bulk of the beer drunk in London. Thus, during the year ending July 5, 1812, no less than 1,318,037 barrels of porter were brewed in London by the 12 principal firms then in existence, whilst during the same period, only about 105,000 barrels of ale were produced. In 1880, there was a complete revision of the mode of taxation to which brewers were subjected, the most important change being the replacement of the duty on malt by a duty on the finished beer, which was fixed at 6 shillings and 3 pence for each barrel of 36 gallons, at a standard original gravity of 1,057 degrees, less an allowance of 6% for unavoidable waste in the manufacturing operations. During succeeding years, this duty was subject to many changes, and at the time of writing it amounts to 7 shillings and 9 pence per barrel of an original gravity of 1,055 degrees, with an allowance of 6% for waste. By original gravity is meant the specific gravity of the wort prior to fermentation, and it is on this that the brewer is taxed, the calculation being always made to a standard specific gravity of 1,055 degrees. At the present time, many different kinds of beer are brewed in this country, of which the more important are mild ale, porter, pale ale, bitter ale, and stout. In addition to these, which are sold both in cask and in bottle, there are less important varieties, peculiar to certain localities, as well as lager beers produced by the decoction system of brewing, which is so widely adopted on the continent and in America. The great bulk of the beer made in this country is consumed by the working classes, whose staple beverages are the so-called mild ale and porter. The mild ale is a lightly hopped beer of medium gravity and of full sweet flavor, which in London is usually drunk when quite new, but which in the country is occasionally kept on draught for 1 or 2 months. Porter is a dark-colored beer, usually of about the same original gravity as the mild ale, and which is devoid of any pronounced hop flavor. Stout is a black beer of higher gravity than porter, which it resembles in being somewhat lightly hopped. Its flavor varies greatly, according to the locality in which it is sold, being sometimes, as in London, sweet and luscious, and at others, as in Ireland, devoid of any pronounced sweetness, or dry. Bitter beers, as the name implies, are characterized by a marked flavor of the hop and are brewed of several strengths. Pale ale, which includes ales intended for export and for storage, is the name usually given to beers of the highest quality. In original gravity, the beers of this class vary very greatly, but they are always pale in color and are almost invariably brewed from the finest materials and represent, in a sense, the highest product of the brewer's art. In connection with the above general descriptions, it should be pointed out that no sharp lines of demarcation can be drawn between any of the varieties mentioned. These overlap very considerably, and in different parts of the country the same name is often applied to beers of very different characters. The history of a beverage which in its various forms has played such an important part in our national and social life for so many centuries is in the highest degree fascinating, and to those who are interested, I commend any or all of the historical works, the titles of which are given in the list on pages 127 and 128. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2. Materials used in brewing. The two essential chemical processes involved in the manufacture of beer are, first, the conversion of starch by means of diastases into certain soluble substances, one of which is a fermentable sugar, and secondly, the decomposition of this sugar by means of the yeast organism into alcohol and carbon dioxide gas. It is clear from this that the main raw material must be one containing starch, and that it should, if possible, contain the necessary converting agent, diastases. Both these conditions are satisfied in the case of certain germinating seeds, and although many have at various times been tried, long experience has showed that germinated barley possesses to the fullest degree the various properties necessary for the brewing of beer. Among other cereals which are occasionally employed are maize, rice, oats, and wheat, but these are always used, when used at all, in conjunction with a large proportion of germinated barley, or, to give it its technical name, malt. Further reference will be made to these cereals later, and for the present I will confine myself to the consideration of barley malt, which is the brewer's chief raw material. Although it is not within the scope of this book to deal at any length with the process of converting barley into malt, some reference to the subject is necessary to ensure a proper understanding of the mashing process, which is one of the most important parts of the whole brewing procedure. The process of malting may be said briefly to consist in artificially inducing the germination of the grain, and when sufficient growth has taken place, in stopping it by the application of heat. Simple as this bare statement may appear, the chemical and physiological changes occurring during the conversion of barley into malt are highly complex, and notwithstanding the vast amount of study devoted to their elucidation, are even now very far from being fully understood. Thanks, however, to the labors of Brown and Morris, and others, the general character of these changes is tolerably clear. If a few corns of barley are bitten between the teeth, they will be found to be very hard, whilst malt corns, tested similarly, will be found to be mealy and friable, and to break down readily. Again, if a handful of barley is ground up and treated with a little warm water, no apparent change will occur, and even at the end of some hours, the addition of a little iodine solution will give the blue color characteristic of starch. If, on the other hand, some ground malt be treated in the same way, it will soon be evident that some chemical change is taking place, for the mixture, if fairly thick to commence with, will rapidly become more liquid, and the solution obtained after straining off the solid matter will be found to have a pleasant, sweet flavor, and on adding a little iodine solution, there will be no blue coloration, showing that the starch has disappeared. It is clear, then, that some very marked changes have attended the transformation of the barley into malt, and these are of the utmost importance to the brewer. The above simple experiment shows that the malt differs from the barley from which it was made, chiefly in containing an active...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.